It's 3. Hi. Oh, wow. Sorry, this is my first time doing this. Hi, I'm Krystal LaPorte. I'm a guest here. This is my general Q&A panel. I guess a brief introduction. I've been working with Sentai Filmworks for about 2.5 years. I started with adaptive lyricism for AKB0048 and wrote the English lyrics. I've been doing voice work since then. Some of the stuff I've been in was Mub Love Alternative Total Eclipse, Log Horizon, anything in the program I've been in. Recently, some stuff that I couldn't put in the program but can talk about now are Kame Ga Kill, Parasite, Beyond the Boundary, Black Bullet. That's about it. This doesn't have to be about anime. I'm a huge horror fan. Doctor Who, Harry Potter, cooking. I think I've done every volunteer staff position at a convention that there is to do at some point in my life. So, yeah.
My job?
No.
Almost every position.
I would call you a technician, a god, a wizard, not because I can't do any of that. So. Been staff or volunteer, just wizard. So I can't provide Q though. I can't provide A unless you guys provide Q. So does anyone have any questions? Awesome. Hi.
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 What was your favorite role so far?
My favorite role so far. I have kind of a few because they've all been such different characters. I think the most challenging one was Mirai Kuriyama from Beyond the Boundary because she has big highs where she's practically manic, and then she has lows where you have to do a lot of sad stuff. So developmentally, I got to go the most places with the same character. And then another one I really liked was Kokina from Black Bullet because she's cray cray, and it was really fun just being psychotic, because even though I am psychotic, I rarely get to show it in society without being in trouble. So that was good. Yay. Thank you.
What would be a role that you would want to play? Like, what's your dream role?
Dream role. I guess I always felt more of a character actor. I normally, for straight acting or straight dramas, I've never been able to really sink my teeth into a role. So a lot of times the really character-y characters are usually male-dominated roles. So I would like to be able to find maybe just someone who's super tomboyish, kind of doesn't give a care and stuff. So, because I've never really done that. I've been very character-y in the past, so I'd like to do something maybe just very straight without a lot of highs or lows. Any other questions? Okay, fine. All right, let's do this. I get to ask you guys questions. So, how many conventions have you been to? Who just asked me a question? Evan, bring the mic. Role reversal.
This is my second time going to Fusion, but I've been to Detour.
I love Detour.
Yeah.
So, No Game, No Life. If you were sucked into a video game, which one would it be?
Don't think I could survive in half the video games out there.
Make money. All right. So you have opened up your new host club. How do you? What is your statement to bring women in, or anyone? How are you going to get customers in?
We have free food.
That's good.
All right.
What is the best movie that you last saw in theaters?
Hang on.
saw Big Hero 6.
Did you like it?
Yes.
Cool.
All right. What is your favorite food?
I'm asking everyone questions. Q&A, I've got an hour.
Ice cream.
Ice cream. All right. What is currently in your DS?
Smash Brothers.
Nice. All right.
Oh, yeah, easy one.
Okay. What type of Pokemon team would you use if you were a gym leader?
Probably Dragon.
Awesome. I like your Charmander.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I can't ask you what's in your DS because I already did, and you closed it on me, so I can't ask a question about the game. All right. Pokemon. Let's see. Okay. If you were a Pokemon trainer, who would be your Pikachu? What's the Pokemon that you would leave outside of its Pokeball to do adventures with you?
Probably Leafeon or Finnegan.
Awesome.
I think my boyfriend has the same exact Hawaiian shirt as you.
Did he get in Hawaii?
No, he didn't.
So I did, so.
Oh, it's not. Okay.
Okay, if you could have a print of anything made into a Hawaiian shirt, what would you want on there so you wore it every day?
Deadpool. Which I think exists, actually.
Yeah, that would be a really cool Hawaiian shirt.
That line.
All right. Okay, now I'm running. Does anyone have any questions? I'm running. Okay.
What's your zombie apocalypse contingency plan?
My zombie apocalypse contingency plan. I would actually try to die first because, like, before it got really, really, like, super apocalyptic. Because I would wait until the zombies were closing in on me, get out my cell phone, and call everyone I don't like and tell them why. And that would be like the best way to go. Because I don't think I'm a survivor. Oh, yes?
Not necessarily the character
voice. Ooh. I think my favorite voice, just because it could shock the people that know me well enough, was probably from Love Love Alternative Total Eclipse, because one, I'm from Chicago. I have a very bad A and kind of nasal. And then Yun Takamura was everything down here. I usually don't speak low. And so everyone who knew me was like, what are you on? And so that was probably the funniest. Any else? I can sit up again? Yes, I'm going to go back up here now. Okay.
What's your favorite horror genre and your main?
Okay, horror genre. I would probably say supernatural thriller because I watch them because I want to see them all, but I'm not like super into the splatfest or gore for gore's sake. Like, with Saw, I see that more as like murder porn. There's not, like, or not Saw, I'm sorry, with Hostel. I see that more as murder porn, but I really loved Saw because there were usually a story behind it, and so even though it was constant, like, death upon death, bloody, oh, that looks really painful, you're wondering, why is he doing this? What is he going to do next? Where's the connection? So I really like when they bring a psychological twist into it, and with supernatural thriller, usually you're finding out the reason why this is or trying to think of the reason why this is happening the whole time, and that's really great. Recently, I would say that one of my favorites has actually been the Insidious trilogy. It's not a lot of gore. It's not even a ton of jump scares, but it had such a creepy atmosphere, and I like the story so much that it let me go home and think about it and talk about it. And I hate stuff that just scares me in the theater, and I go home and I haven't taken anything. I like stuff that really keeps me up. I really like J-horror, and Ju-on is the one that scared me the most. I couldn't open my medicine cabinet without thinking there was going to be a small child meowing at me, and that tore me up for a few years. Yeah. Any more questions? Yes.
Do you cosplay, and if you do, what's your favorite?
Wow. Okay. I've cosplayed a lot. I haven't done it in a long time, just because I started school last year, and it's just takes up a lot of my life, but I've done a lot of cosplay. I would say that maybe my two favorites, that was my first form Frieza. I did the full armor out of Ava foam, and then I did the the helmet and the horns out of, like, I did a plasti dip over Warbler, and I did the face paint, and it was so much fun, and I had a tail, so I can do this with my tail. And then the other one I did with my best friend, we did Jesse and James from Team Rocket, and I was only able to wear it twice because it hurt my neck so much, but it was a 6-pound wig that I made with a steel skeleton, and then I put paper mache over it, and then felt, and then actually hair, so that, and then I leveled it with fishing weights in the front, so that to balance it out, and so then it actually had the whole thing that went like this. So that was really fun, because I also like Dragon Ball Z and Pokemon a lot. Yeah. Anything else? Yes?
Favorite anime series?
Well, Dragon Ball Z is pretty much a big obsession, so much so that I put it in the program because I love my Dragon Ball Z collection and I love the show. But so I'm going to try to think of something besides that for that. I really like artistic looking ones, and I like ones that kind of make you, like I said, it's kind of a mystery, you wonder what you're going to think. I really like Kaiba and Mononoke. Not Princess Mononoke, there's one, and I think it's on Hulu right now, about a medicine seller who, every arc is standalone. He goes, and there's something haunting a house, and he needs to find out, like, the who, the what, and the why. What is the spirit? Like, who were they in there when they were living? What are they haunting with, or why they're doing it, and it usually is because of something that somebody in the household or the building has done, and so it's kind of like a murder mystery game of Clue with anime and ghost elements in every arc. It's very good, and some of it's really sad too. It's very pretty. Anything else? Yes?
Do you watch the anime that you
voice? Not always. For Muv Luv Alternative, I did. For Black Bullet, I did. For Beyond the Boundary, I did, because I also proof for the studio. So I also get to, like, see it in its second to completely final stage. Trying to think if there were any other ones that I've watched afterwards. No. They're usually on Hulu or the Anime Network. I try to watch them before I go in if I have the time. If I only have a few days notice, I'll at least watch, like, one of the big episodes so that I can see, like, what they're kind of about, so I can go in there with some idea of what the director's going to ask for. Sometimes the voice that I think, yeah, this looks like a good voice, this looks like what I want to do, is the complete opposite of what the director wants, and in that case you always go with the director, because as actors I feel like we're kind of tools that the director uses to sort of make this show alive as they've seen it, because their job is to make the anime that they think is going to make the fans the happiest, and if I'm a part of that, then I'm hopefully making the fans happiest. Yeah. You just have one, yeah. Anything else? Someone go first. Got a few. My first one is that if anyone's ever seen the show Shining Hearts, Caitlin's seen it. There's a scene where they're attacked by pirates, and everyone is sad, and everyone's crying and screaming, and in buried deep down in the walla is me screaming and crying to let me out of the booth, because I'm horrible at this and I really don't like it, and please stop, please stop, please stop, because I did not want to go in the booth the first time I was trying it. They're just like, come on, do some wall. I'm like, I don't like this. I can hear my voice in these headphones. I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't like it. And so that's in there. And then for Beyond the Boundary, there was a scene where for reasons that I don't want to say without giving away, the characters really smell bad. And they, at one point, my character doesn't change all of her garments, so it still smells. And some people in front of them are talking, and they start smelling it, and she's embarrassed, so she wants to blame it on the person walking next to her, so she does a fake fart sound, like, and she goes, wow, excuse you, and then they laugh at that person. I was not really, they wanted me to make, like, a really good fart sound, and I just wasn't doing it well, so I spent, like, 4 minutes in the booth just going, for, like, 4 minutes, and they're like, good, that's the fart we wanted. So, that's the culmination of my acting. Works. Yes?
Are there any upcoming shows that you're aware of you'd like to work on?
Oh, I'm sorry, I couldn't...
Oh, upcoming shows you'd like to work on?
Upcoming shows that I would like to work on? From the ones that I haven't been able to watch a ton, I saw the first episode of School Live, and that was pretty awesome, and I would really like to be a part of that because I love horror anime. I know that we got two licenses recently, Sentai did, but I don't have any idea whether they're dubbing them or not, to two shows that I adore, Higurashi no Nakakoro ni and Legend of the Galactic Heroes. If those were ever dubbed, I would love to be a part of them. But really, I mean, if it's an anime that needs dubbing, I would be really happy to be in it because I love working. And half of them I haven't seen before I was cast, and I found so many really good shows that way. So I try not to think, ooh, I really hope I'm in this, because if I'm not, I'm disappointed. If I am, I'm just as happy as if I'm in a show that I've never seen before. And anything else? Oh, yes.
What was your first role?
Like my first like named role?
Nat Walla.
Okay. Nat Walla was Shiori Asagiri in Tamako Market. She was kind of like the shy friend. It's a great show, and I was just talking about it. It's about this bird who's looking for a bride for his prince from an island, and his prince isn't a bird. And so he lands in this town, and he finds the girl. She's the daughter of a man who runs a mochi shop, and he thinks he'd be good, but he can't go back to tell his prince because he eats too much mochi and gets fat. So he can't fly anymore. So it's a slice of life that is showing the daily lives of these girls in this town, which is like a shopping district, through the eyes of this fat, flightless bird. It's really good. And he's played by Jay Hickman in the dub, who is just, he's amazing. And everything he says makes him sound like a horrible person who's just so full of himself. But he's the nicest guy. And he gets that out there, and it's amazing. He's very talented. I recommend it. Caitlin's in that show too, so I'm going to point her out. Okay. Yes?
Say if I was somebody who can do like a lot of impressions, but I don't really have any theater experience to back up voice acting, are there other avenues of voice acting that you could do on the side to get into, like for like cartoons or like small roles?
Well, I think usually with auditions, they really, really want some acting experience. However, if you don't want to do that and you want some time, someone who's very good at impressions could actually probably make a killing in commercial radio, because a lot of times with acting for animation and video games, someone will say, well, if we want someone that sounds like Peter Dinklage, we're gonna just hire Peter Dinklage. If we want someone who sounds like Morgan Freeman, they're gonna hire Morgan Freeman. With radio, they might want someone who can do five different spots as Morgan Freeman, John Goodman, Peter Dinklage, this person. So impressionists actually are probably going to be very high in demand in that. Once you do that, that's something to add to your resume, and you can start getting other work and develop maybe your own voices that you've come up with and look into other avenues of animation. Another big thing is living in the area. If you're from here, you aren't really close to the hubs of anime, which is going to be like Los Angeles, Dallas, Houston, Vancouver, but you're going to be closer to places like Chicago, which are great hubs for commercial. So there's ways to do it no matter what, but I mean, most of the people that I've heard say that acting experience and voice acting for like cartoons is really, really helpful. Anything else? Okay.
You should explain why your hair is
purple. Oh, why my hair is... Yeah. We were talking about this, and my hair is purple because October is Domestic Awareness Month, or Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And right now, I'm in law school, and I'm doing domestic violence advocacy. That's also what I did all summer. I worked with our prosecutors in their child abuse unit, and if any domestic violence involved a child, I would help with that case. When people ask me about my purple hair, I explain what that is and ask them to look at like local charities for if there's a way to donate to that. This year, actually, at Anime Fusion, the proceeds for the charity auction go to Cornerstone, which is also a domestic violence charity. So everyone do your part and go to the charity auction. Yay. Anything else? Oh, and it's shampoo. Anything else? Oh, yes?
If you were a Pokemon trainer, who would your Pokemon be?
Ghost and Haunter would be my best friend. Because I love Haunter. I actually, in the dealer's room, if anyone's gone in the artist alley, this girl has this amazing booth, and it's got all of these awesome ghost Pokemon. Like, they have a whole Halloween theme going on. They've got Nightmare Before Christmas, they've got phone charms of ghost Pokemon. It's really, really cute, so y'all should go see it. I bought a phone charm of Haunter, Ghastly, and Gengar, and they're hanging out, but my phone doesn't have room for charms, so I realized that then. Yep. Cool. Yes?
I was just looking in the program that said you're in the martial arts. Do you compete in the martial arts you do?
I don't anymore. It was something that I did before I left for my undergraduate degree. I tried, I did Kyukido, which is a Korean type MMA, and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I competed then. I stopped competing when I was like, say 18 or 19. I tried Kuksul One after that, but the dojos weren't the same as the one that I was in, so it just didn't have the atmosphere. And then after that, when I moved to Texas, I thought I was gonna try to go back into jiu-jitsu, but law school absorbs everything. So, I did with that. I was between Illinois, Michigan, and Indiana. I don't know why it was those three, but I was the champion for jiu-jitsu. For ones that I've done for free fighting and forms in Kyukido, I have done those, but it was only between Illinois schools in the same federation. Yes?
Is your focus in law school gonna be domestic violence or something else?
Right now, my focus in law school, what I wanna do is I wanna be a children's advocate in divorce situations, because it annoys me and makes me sad when I see lawyers charging exorbitant fees for custody battles, and then parents who might not be in the best of financial situations or are even in good financial situations at the time have to spend a ton of money to either get custody of their children or to get the stuff, when really, if they talk it out, sometimes in like a controlled setting, they can actually come to an agreement that they can both live with and spend the money on their children instead of my wave runner. And so a lot of times lawyers will say, oh, well, I'm fairly confident that you can get everything, or you can get them for all they work, and they stoke the fires, and they do stuff, and then the parents might do stuff that they originally would not have, and so I kind of want to be the anti-that. So I work between advocacy and mediation, and with mediation, I do like a shuttle diplomacy. If two people are in a dispute, you can rent out a building that is great for mediation, where they have all rooms that are basically the same exact rooms, and then a meeting room, and they meet there, they give a presentation on what their demands are, what their side of the story is, and then they leave, and then you do private caucuses with them, shuttling back and forth, making offers, and taking back the counter offers, telling them when they rejected it, and the only time they ever meet again is when they've agreed on an offer. And meeting again when they're in agreement also improves the relationship with them for the future, so that they can both work to parent their children together. So it's something important to me. Yes?
Not a question, but a comment. Watch a documentary on Netflix called Divorce Court. I think it might be very informative for you. It talks all about family court for like about an hour and a half.
Divorce Court?
Court, yeah, like corporation, yeah.
I'm going to be really rude and put that in my memos right now. I'm sorry to be on my phone during the panel, but I really want to see that.
Everything you just said is all in that documentary and more. It's really eye-opening.
That's really awesome. Thank you so much. I feel bad now. I'm taking notes. Okay. Anything else? Sing along, we could yes.
With getting such a big role as Mira in Beyond Bond, does that open up a lot more avenues for you in the future?
Not necessarily, not really, no. I mean, granted, more people might hear it, but the directors, at least at Sentai Filmworks, which is where I live, I've worked with all of them already. I think as far as Avenue goes, it just lets me connect with a lot more fans, because before then, they might not have seen me in something, and so they might not have known to show up to a panel where I meet them, or they do that. But besides that, not really. I mean, it was a large role, so I got to work a lot on my acting skills, and like I said earlier, I got to go places with one character that I'd never gone before. So I feel coming out of it, I'm a much better actress. So the improvements and experience I've gained working on it are probably the most door-opening things I got out of it. But that, and I got to find a really good anime that I became a really big fan of and spent way too much money on merchandise of and music from. It's a really good show. Caitlin's in it. That's like my theme of the day. Caitlin's in it. She's really good. Do you want to come say hi? You could.
Yeah.
Yeah. Caitlin French is a very talented voice actress living in Houston, Texas. So she's good. No, you're in Austin. Oh my God, I'm in Houston. I was on the program. She hangs out in Austin. She's cool people. So now, if you have a question for her too, we could do that because we have 28 minutes. Or we are 28 minutes past 3, we have 30 minutes, and there's a Hoenn map, so I'm actually planning out my way to defeat, like 4, yeah, that's Hoenn. Thank you. Hello, oh wow, that was a lot louder than I expected. Hi.
Oh, you make quieter.
I have a tiny voice, so I wasn't expecting tiny voice to go so loud. Yeah. So,
I just got added to this mix. Hi.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, she probably is going to regret that.
Yay. What?
You're going to regret having me up here. You know this.
No. My family's here. Are you threatening my family?
No, you're just your sanity.
Yeah, I brought my grandma and my mom because my... Well, I didn't know I was bringing my mom, but I brought my grandma, and I'm very excited about that. They're celebrating their birthdays. My Nana's birthday is this weekend. My mom's birthday was on Wednesday. And we thought, what better way to celebrate it with anime, which you have never seen before. So, if you see a 4'8" Italian woman wondering what's going on, you probably should point her in my direction because she's lost. But she's very cool. She bought me my first piece of anime merchandise, which, if anyone remembers, in Toys R Us, 14 years ago, they had those Dragon Ball Z walkie-talkies, and, they were the figures, and you could talk into their chests. The voice would come out of the other chest, and she bought me the non-Super Saiyan Goku and Piccolo combination. And then my mom showed me my first anime, which was Princess Mononoke. And, I've tried showing my Nana anime, but she doesn't understand where the Pokemon are, because I was so big into Pokemon and Dragon Ball Z as a kid, tried showing her Tomoko Market and it had the fat bird, and she's like, now is that the Pokemon? Is that the Pokemon? No, that's a bird. Well then, where's the Pokemon? There isn't one, and I showed her Muvlove, and because it looked like more not as cartoony as Tomoko Market, she's like, oh, so where's Piccolo? Is Piccolo in this one? I don't know why I'm British now, but I am. I don't understand. Oh my God, those are breasts. So we were just talking about maybe one day just recording her reactions, because she reacts so colorfully to stuff. and just like make a react to anime, op in a hentai for our anniversary episode. This isn't about the Bible at all.
So good to say, Bible black time?
But I she's very, very fun, and they're taking a nap now because they drove up 5 hours to be here, so she'll be walking around with me eventually. Any questions for either of us?
Favorite DBZ character?
Piccolo. He's just the best because he's so underrated, but he's like there when you need him. If I had a friend, he'd be Piccolo.
I'm going to also fall in that Piccolo category. We have had this conversation about our first anime awkward crushes.
Oh, I didn't want to bring that up.
Well, I am, because I have no shame. We've all had them. We've all had those awkward anime crushes. We're like, oh, man. Yeah, mine was Piccolo. Yeah. It was really odd. And then you found out Namics don't have other gender, and you're like, oh, that just made everything a little more awkward. Well, oh, well.
No, we were doing that. We were talking because I have a really ungodly, like my whole corner of my room is Dragon Ball Z throughout like 15 years of collecting, and so I just couldn't get rid of it. I couldn't get rid of any of my toys after watching Toy Story 3, so pretty much everything's a collection at this point, because
this is how hoarding happens.
If you get rid of them, they might get like melted in a trash compactor. So I can't get rid of any toys now. Yeah. Who's your favorite Dragon Ball Z character?
Piccolo.
Yeah! So it's just a fact. It's an objective fact. It's not subjective. Piccolo's best.
No joke!
You are one of a kind, sir. You are one of a kind.
Has anyone seen that figure that they just released of dead Yamcha? Yeah. It's a figure of dead Yamcha. He's like huddled to the ground, and I really want to buy one and use it as a paperweight. Because I think it'd be great if I just walk in, if people walk into my my mediation room or my law office, and I'd be like, oh, excuse me, here are your files. Oh, yes, remove the dead man. Okay. Great. Any more questions?
Favorite type of candy?
Kit
Kat bars or jawbreakers? Really love me some jawbreakers.
I like jawbreakers. I don't like Kit Kat. Ooh, you know what? I like Twix. Runts. I love Runts. Yeah.
Only the bananas.
During finals, like my trash. I normally am very healthy. I love vegetables and fish, but then during finals crunch week when I don't want to work, my room just becomes an explosion of Runt boxes and Cheeto bags, and it's so weird. I'm fine, but then when finals are over, I like look around. I'm like, what happened to me? Where was I?
It sounds like college. Yeah.
So. Really want some Cheetos now. Any more questions? Yeah.
If you had to be trained in any profession by any anime character, anything, who would it be and what would the profession be?
Oh, that's so fun! Okay. You're the veteran voice actress, you can go first.
Oh my gosh, I'm trying to think of a good example. The only anime I could think of, I got this. I was gonna say, I was a little stuck in a corner with one. I'm like, oh, wait. So, if everybody doesn't know me, I'm a huge professional wrestling fan. If the Dean Ambrose jacket doesn't give it away and the female Seth Rollins hair I got going on, so I'm a huge pro wrestling fan, and I thought I was stuck in a corner with one of the world's strongest for a moment. But I was in Myochiki where I was given the role of a girl who is obsessed with pro wrestling because apparently the studio, the director's like, well, it'd kind of be wrong to cast anybody else as this part. So I wouldn't get trained by my characters per se, but her mom, you never see her in the show, but she's pretty much left her son and daughter on their own so she can go wrestle bears and tigers because no one in Japan is strong enough. So she just goes out and wants to fight animals all the time, which eventually leads to Kuroha trying to wrestle a bear that is voiced by George Manley, which now every time I see George Manley, I scream bear at him and try and wrestle him. But yeah, I'd probably get trained in pro wrestling by them because that'd go so, so well for Tiny Me.
Well, I had to just talk about mediation, so I thought being trained by Frieza in Conflict Revolution would be really funny. Resolution, not revolution. But for law, maybe I would have Miles Edgeworth tutor me for the bar exam, and then Manfred von Karma teach me prosecution. If anyone's seen Phoenix Wright, or played Phoenix Wright, it's a good game that's getting turned into an anime soon. To be honest, I knew I was going to be a lawyer since I was like 9, so I never opened myself up to any other possibilities. So, yeah. Any more questions? Yes.
Do you watch any law shows like How to Get Away with Murder or anything?
I shamelessly am obsessed with Drop Dead Diva, which is like a really awesome show. It's a what?
Sorry, every time I see it, I just think of Drop Dead Gorgeous.
I have not finished that movie. I started it. I know. I'm trash. I know. But Drop Dead Diva, it's like a chick flicks Law and Order about, have you seen it? You were on it? Oh my, I'm sorry. Okay, well, I'm obsessed.
I got like a one little role on one episode. We can talk about it later.
Well, yeah. It's,
I think we found Leslie.
Hi.
Hi. I'm sorry I didn't mention. So, do you want to come up here?
No, you guys.
Okay. It's about a model who gets tragically killed under a truck full of tons of grapefruits. And then she is resuscitated, but in the body of a lawyer. But now she has the smarts to like do it, to like do the law, but she doesn't realize it. So she'll be like, oh, I know this statute. And then she does law. But it's fabulous. Oh, but then the lawyer's body comes back in another model's body, and then she like has to convince her fiance from when she was a model that she's like, that she loves him, but she can't tell him that she's actually his dead fiance. There's drama. It's good. It's fabulous. Any more questions? Yes. Okay, I used to watch Perry Mason with my grandma and my grandpa, and he annoyed me because they would always talk about how smart he was, and I was going to be a lawyer too. So like, why wasn't I smart? And I don't know, that was just like 7-year-old me. We watched that, I watched a few shows with them that were like that I remember really well. There was one called that one, and then there was Perry Mason, there was Murder, She Wrote, there was Columbo, and then there was Poirot, which came back into my life because my boyfriend's obsessed with Poirot, who has anyone seen Poirot? So, okay, I'm very conflicted because of one thing he said with Murder on the Nile that convinces me that he is a horrible person. And my boyfriend thinks that he is just the most wonderful person in the world. So when I get mad at him, I'll call him Poirot. And he'll be like, thank you. I know what it means, but I take it as a compliment. So, any more questions? Yes.
Each of you could be one of the characters that you voice act with, but would you be and why?
I'm a huge gamer, so I'd be Shiro. From No Game, No Life, because I have no life sometimes. Also just because I find her a very fun character despite age and monotoneness. There's something about her that I just really enjoy, and it's kind of how she approaches life with this very lackadaisical attitude of, She can approach it, not care, but when she does care, she's on top of it. And she kind of gets by that way. And to be fair, the people who can do that, I'm really envious of, because most of us spend our time trying all the time to get somewhere. It's a little envious that she can kind of just go through life. I think my favorite quote from her is, "Contempt people are just a myth."
I like that.
I would probably be Yui Goido from The World God Only Knows, because she's rich. And I would probably not die in that world, so I could actually enjoy the richness. I mean, look at me, I can't fight aliens or demons or... Well, I mean, I could live in a town with a talking bird, but I wouldn't have any money. And my parents aren't rich. And yeah, no, I'd be the rich one with both parents who lives. What?
Nothing.
I just... Has anyone seen Love Love? Oh, have you seen the aliens? Could you imagine me duking it out with a beta? Oh, that's
still give me nightmares.
Okay, well, if they have nightmares, I'm really excited. I loved the show a lot, and I've looked up the Wikipedia for the visual novel, and I've always been like, I wish I could play this. And they just did a Kickstarter for the localization of the visual novels, and they are so close to the localization of not only the visual novels, but all their side stories, because the Kickstarter is doing awesome. And I got, and I contributed to it, so I'm getting a beta plush and a beta hoodie, so I can be an alien.
I'm gonna have Dead Space nightmares because of you for weeks.
I know, I see, the cool thing with, if ever, anyone has a smartphone, look up Soldier Class Beta, they are just the cutest things, but unfortunately they're horrifying. But the hoodie is like the top torso, and it's got padded, a padded hood, so you actually get the eyes and the mouth and stuff, so I can just put it on and like nuzzle you.
Never sleeping again.
That's gonna be fun. I don't get it for like a year because Kickstarter, but keeps me going. any other questions? Yes.
Well, in Love Love, I started out the first episode of like a pilot. All these characters, and you're like, this is going to be a great show with all these characters.
Nope.
Nope.
Nope. Nope. Yeah, when I saw it, I was like, oh my goodness, I've seen some things. So, it's a very good show. If anyone's into mecha, it's a mecha, it's romance. But the first episodes, my character is very, very kind of, I would say, little bitter, very serious. She's seen some things, and the first two episodes are the things that she's seen to turn her into a happy, kind of carefree, hopeful person, into just this ice cold, what are you doing here? So it's a good show. Anything? Yes.
Sometimes I'm really bad at putting voices towards characters. Were you the one that ended up shooting our friend in the first episode?
I missed, so I wouldn't call it that, but yes. Yeah, that's me. I couldn't kill Kira Vincent Davis. But she was awesome in that too. It's I screamed a lot in that show. Anything else? Yes.
If you woke up one day and you were in an anime, what kind of anime would you be in?
Mine would probably have to be something like Gate, where you have like the crossover between worlds of, you have like normal life and then you have a fantasy world. But I like to think of it as, you'd start the anime thinking you were in a fantasy world, and then randomly it turns slice of life and it's just a bunch of people playing tabletop and D&D or Pathfinder. And so it goes between the slice of life to this epic fantasy to slice of life again with comedy.
Dungeons and Dragons and Chunibyo.
I'm pretty sure Chunibyo covers all of that, of thinking I'm a level 10 paladin with a plus 6 charisma modifier.
I was thinking that too. I was thinking fantasy slice of life, because for there to be a slice of life, There has to be life so I wouldn't die and I can enjoy magic.
You're bitter about this dying thing, aren't you?
You know, anime is so cool, but I burn my toast. Like, I can't survive that. I can't even make toast. So, what? Like, if I went to these fantasy worlds, who's to know I'm not going to be stepped on by a dragon within 5 seconds and I don't get to enjoy it? So, I got to think small. Yeah. Any more questions? Yes.
If you had to be trapped in a horror movie, which one would it be?
Okay, you know what? I'll just suck it up. I'll be a Nightmare on Elm Street because I love those movies with every fiber of my being. Wouldn't even run, recognize I'd die. I'd make sure I have alcohol on me and just be like, yeah, got to meet you. That's pretty cool. I enjoyed your movies. Yeah. So, oh, would you like a drink? Okay, yeah. And then I'd die.
I'd have to go with a Del Toro of like Pan's Labyrinth. Where you get the, first off, I really love Spanish horror, and Del Toro in general is, I love Del Toro, which is just gonna put that right out there, but.
The pale man looks like a beta.
He does.
I hope you get chased by him.
Oh, thanks! Sorry, I deafened everybody with the mic, but yeah, definitely something that crosses that line. I'm gonna lick you in a moment. It's something like Pan's Labyrinth where you're, again, I really like the balance of going between a world that we know is established that melts away into a fantasy world. And I think fantasy, when done in certain ways, they take something like fae that is very abstract and oftentimes used in a positive light, because when you think happy fairies and everything, I really love when people take that and they twist it into a horrid sense that's a more of a grim fairy tale type of tragedy horror situation. It's not considered your shocking horror, but it's a nice departure from what we've been given as children, because we always see fairy tales as happy. They have these happy endings when you get to the base text, but then you start looking at mythology and a lot of the stories with Grimm's Hans Christian Andersen and all that. They have some really terrible things happen. So when people take that and they twist it, and they give that to you. It's the one reason I love Into the Woods so much is it's more real, it's more great. It's just so good. So I know it'd be terrifying, but I'd still really want to be in that one.
Yeah, grim fairy tales made me way afraid of birds before Alfred Hitchcock did, because if you are in a fairy tale and there are birds involved, you are using your eyes. But
you're not Prometheus.
I was kind of stuck in a horror film once, but not really, but I was like level of terrified. Has anyone ever seen Dead Silence? It was a horror film about killer dummies, like ventriloquism dummies. I was terrified. I was like 14, but I also really, really wanted to be a ventriloquist at that point. So I have a replica of Slappy, the dummy from Goosebumps. And I got home from seeing this horrifying film with a dummy that looks really similar to Slappy. And I asked my parents, like, could I please take him out of my room? And they're like, no, your stuff goes in your room. If your stuff is not in your room, then it's not your stuff, and we can throw it out. That is an ugly doll. The moment it leaves your room, I get to throw it out. So I got to stare at him as I fell asleep. I made amends to die that night. Yeah. Any more questions?
Are you going to watch the Goosebumps movie?
Yeah.
And be freaked out?
No, I'm not going to be freaked out. I'm better now and older. And I just want to see all the movies come to life because I loved those books so much as a kid. And like, there's so many. I was going to be like, that's the haunted mask and that's that and that's that. And it's going to be a nostalgia trip. Yeah. Yeah, I know they're cashing in on it, but I'm excited. Oh, yes.
What anime are you?
DBC. I mean, there's a lot.
So I have two that kind of send me. Like, DBC, yeah. But my first anime was Sailor Moon. But I also really loved Ronin Warriors because the Ancient reminded me of Raiden from Mortal Kombat. And as a child, I was very much obsessed with that. So Ronin Warriors always had my brain in that fantasy Chunubia world. I don't know why, but that between that and Sailor Moon, my brain was... You had like the magical boys and the magical girls. You had both on USA. They just didn't call the boys whose magical armor appears on them magical boys. They were the cool samurai and why we had the magical girls. But
does anyone remember the Sky Dancers show? Did anyone
else? I had so many Sky Dancers. I think my mom was so mad I hit her with those and I'm just watching them.
That wasn't really anime, but I remember the Sky Dancers show. I thought that was the coolest thing, and I thought that if I spinned around, I might become important. So I just did a lot of spinning, not the other thing. Anything else?
Can I get the song?
Yes?
What was your first acting role ever, like Counting Elementary School?
Counting Elementary School? My first acting role ever was in... 5th grade as the Wicked Witch of the West in The Wizard of Oz. And there's actually a story that I told you about, yeah. There's actually a story that involves a school counselor as well. I didn't talk much as a kid. There wasn't really much to say. There just wasn't, I was smart, I was happy, just didn't talk. But I also did not come from the best home situation, and it was very, very, all of the teachers knew about it. And the counselors, and so for the Wicked Witch of the West, this was 5th grade, and I had this voice, and everything was like this, and I did the laugh, and I did this, and that, and that. And it was the first time that probably half of the student body had heard me speak. And so after that, everyone loved it. After that, I get called into the counselor's office, and she tells me how proud she was of me. She's like, I'm just so glad that you were able to channel your anger and your hurt into a helpful avenue, into art. And she didn't understand. I was like, this is Longwell. I was trying to sound like Willem Dafoe in Spider-Man. I was doing a Green Goblin impersonation. And she was like, oh, I didn't say any of that. Oh, and then she just felt awkward around me for the rest of the year. I was like... I'll talk to you if I have problems. Hey, Green Goblin. So, yep, that was my first acting role.
I was a little girl, and they put me in the Scottish play Macbeth as one of the apparition children. And my first acting experience was going on stage reciting Shakespeare with blood running down my face. Because I was the bloody apparition child, which started my love for Shakespeare following that.
What's your favorite Shakespeare play?
Midsummer Night's Dream. I love Midsummer Night's Dream. And that is like the one show I have not been in yet that I really want to be in.
We were talking about we talk about weird stuff when I'm about to fall asleep, that's when all the weird stuff happens, when I'm on a car ride. So we were talking about periods we would want to put Shakespeare in. No, we wouldn't. Has anyone seen A Midsummer Night's Dream? Southern Annabelle era.
Wouldn't that be,
because Puck could be the coyote spirit, because he's the trickster. You have Oberon and Titania as, I'm thinking the bear and the dove. And the entire culture shock would be Antebellum Southern era North American.
All I can think about is the massive American layers of those skirts as the two lead females, but before they finally get to the fight where they're wrestling down.
You've got the cages going everywhere.
You get the cages. You have the layers upon layers of clothing that they're slowly losing while they're out there. That would be pretty hilarious.
Yeah. Any other questions? Sorry. Yes.
Marvel or DC?
I have to pick?
Yep. If you had to pick just one, the other one vanished forever.
Oh, man. That's... You're a terrible person. Because, I want to keep the Batman universe of DC and everything else could go away.
But Spider-Man is Marvel and you take away my Spider-Man?
No!
Why are they doing that game?
I don't remember. I wouldn't want to banish the X-Men either.
Okay, sorry.
Because I feel both studios, they both have good things. things about them. DC has a solid Bat universe. If they stop DCing it up, where they decide to expand it far too fast, which is what I feel like they did with Young Justice, they have a solid team of five, six characters they're introducing, and after season one, they jump and give you a bunch of characters you don't care about because they're like, oh, we need to expand the universe. Here's all these characters. We're going to throw them in your face. You need to care about them, which is what DC does. They've done it with Flash. They've done it with all this stuff, so they don't gradually build. Marvel is so much better at gradual build-up, but they're so bad about having good female characters, it drives me absolutely bonkers. Because, I mean, in the Marvel Universe right now, you have Black Widow. You have Black Widow. And you could go and think of, huh, what's all their other lead females? Oh, wait, Storm. Then you have Kitty Pryde. Then you have Rogue. And then every other female that comes out of my mouth is a X-Men who Marvel doesn't have right now.
You have the White Rabbit in Marvel, who's like my favorite female villain at least. Have you heard of her?
White Rabbit.
White, yeah.
There's one in Batman too called White Rabbit.
And she was also in Wolverine. They expanded her, but I don't think they...
What?
She started out in Spider-Man. It was a comic issue
okay,
of Spider-Man
DC
and the...
too, that I'm like, okay, why are you telling me about the laundry?
It might not be that one,
girl.
I'm sorry. But it started with the Fantastic Spider-Man and the Fantastic Frogman versus the White Rabbit. She was a rich heiress who married rich. When the guy died, she inherited everything and spent all of her money turning her house into like an Alice in Wonderland themed Temple of Doom. And then she originally had like the Walrus and the Mad Hatter and all that, but she kept failing as the series went on, to the point where the last we saw her in the Spider-Man universe, Spider-Man's about to punch one of her henchmen. He goes, man, I'm just an actor. What? No other villains will work with her. She's so bad at what she does that she hires actors to play henchmen just to fill up space. And she's pretty fantastic. She forgot what the villain is in Wolverine, but she ends up on an island with him, so she's happy.
She didn't save her too?
No, he's like a trickster-ish,
Loki?
Mm-mm. Kinda reminds me of the Riddler meets the Mad Hatter. I'll find out.
There's too many crossovers, and I'm like, DC or Marvel?
We've got 2 minutes, so time for one quick question, speed round. Anyone? Going once? Going twice? Oh, yes. Voldemort.
Luna Lovegood.
I always think that if I were in the Harry Potter universe, I kept saying that I would really think it'd be cool to be a Death Eater because, to be honest, killing people that I don't like with no accountability is really tempting. But I would die after like a day because the temptation to say that I pranked the Dark Lord would also be too high. So we were talking about sending a howler that would say it's about the whereabouts of Harry Potter, and then when he opens it goes, and his name is John Cena! And that's how I'd die.
I'm not sure dying over John Cena is worth much of anything.
Yeah, well, it's just me.
And you're that's the John panel. Cena.
But what if Voldemort's a John Cena fan?
Well,
I
think I'll be skipping my next panel to go write a fan fiction. Thank you guys so much for coming. It was really fun hanging out. If you find me, say hi so that I can actually like meet people. But yeah, thank you guys again. Really appreciate it. Thank you, Caitlin. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.